Hello everyone, welcome to the course IMK 221, Food Ingredients. This is the main website, the science of food ingredients, which you can use to refer for the whole course, because in this website, when you go under ingredients, you will see all the different topics which we are going to cover during the 14 weeks of this course. Okay, let me go through the content of the course. So as you can see here, the pictures that you can see on the slide here, the colorful, different kind of food, which you are very familiar. And these food are only possible and made available to the consumers because of the technology of food ingredients, which the food technologies have developed over the years. So as a food technologist, you should be able, or you should have the knowledge of the different types of food ingredients. So these are some of the learning outcomes. So at the end of the course, you should be able now to describe the different types of food ingredients commonly used in food industry, and also the science and the chemistry behind each of the food ingredients. You should be able to describe the structure, the function, and the specific application of food ingredients, because you will find you will discover that each ingredient or additive that we use sometimes have more than one functions. And then once you have understood the types, the structure, the functions, and the application, you should now be able to identify an appropriate ingredient that can be used in a given product. So this is very important in the product development process, where you need to be able to identify what kind of ingredients suitable for the products and for the functions that you want to achieve. Then you will develop an understanding of how the selection of an ingredient is related to the chemical, biochemical, and physical changes in food during processing and storage. When we choose a specific type of ingredients, we should be able to predict whether during processing the ingredient will withstand the processing condition due to the acidity or the temperature, and whether it will change, for example, the color, for example, can change at different pH and also at different temperature. So with the knowledge, you can, you have the understanding of what kind of ingredient that will be suitable under the conditions of or the processing that you're going to subject the food to. And use the knowledge learned in this course as guiding principles in formulating new product or improving quality of existing product and for broader application in food product development. So those are the learning outcome that at the end of this course you should be able to achieve. Let's see how the history or the development of food ingredients since the old time, from the hunters where they get the food for the day, and the variety of food at that time is very limited, to the early farmers when they start to produce food more systematically, when they learn to farm, and then to the agricultural revolution of the 18th century when foods are produced in large scale. And then, they learn how to process the food and make it more shelf stable. And then from there, this is where, we start to develop different ingredients to make the food more palatable and to get a different variety, different flavors, different colors, different texture, and so on. And all these are made possible with food ingredients or food additive. So from hunters to a modern lifestyle. So as you can see, one of the reasons why we want to process the food is to suit the modern lifestyle where people are busy working, so they want to have the food ready. You can just buy the food and grab the food from the supermarket and eat, or they just need a very simple process. So we will make the food technologies actually make the food more convenient by processing the food into something more, stable, very delicious, and very convenient. and need very, very minimum preparation before they can be eaten or can be consumed. So modern lifestyle has thoroughly changed in the last few decades. Activities away from home have reduced the amount of time consumers spend in the kitchen, hence increased demand on processed food and convenient food ingredients. So the development of food ingredients, necessary, and the food technologies and chemists work together to produce all sorts of food ingredients and additives. And the use of a variety of food ingredients combined with new technology has made possible the large-scale preparation of good, wholesome food at economical price, as you can see in this picture here. And the use of food additives also allows us to have access to many convenience foods, such as instant desserts, prepared dishes, snacks, and so on. At this point, maybe I want to draw your attention. The term that we use here, food ingredients, which the name we use for the course, and food additives. What is the difference between food ingredients and food additive? Well, basically anything that goes to the food that we use to formulate the food, those are the ingredients, you know, ingredients that we list in the recipe. But then there are a group of ingredients which we categorize as food additive according to the food law. Well, for example, in our case, Malaysian Food Act, and the additives are basically the permitted additive that can be used in food under the law at certain amount for certain application, and usually they are used in a very small amount to give a certain specific functions. And other than those categorized or grouped as food additives, those are the other ingredients that we use. So food additives also are part of the ingredients we use in our food. So the development of food ingredients over the years by food technologies and chemists is to provide high quality, safe and delicious food products. And these are readily available to meet the ever increasing demand of consumers in affluent modern society. And this is made possible with the availability of diverse types of food ingredients. So I hope I have made this very clear to you, the reason and the rationale why as a food technologist we need to know, to take this course and know and understand and be able to describe the different type of food ingredients, the specific function in a given product, and their stability and their suitability to be used in certain food depending on the type of processing we use to produce the product. Once you know and about food ingredients, now you should be able to read the food label and you have the knowledge to, you know, to explain to someone else and be able to interpret what is in the list of the food ingredients. So I would expect at the end of this course, when you read the food label, you should be able to make an informed, you have sufficient knowledge to explain each of the ingredient listed on the product. And as a food technologist, of course, you should be competent enough to explain the role and the functions of every single ingredient and additive listed on the food label. For example, let's look at this product, Hershey's Chocolate Kisses. So deciphering means you should be able to explain the meaning or the function of the ingredient in the list label. So for this product, there are two parts. One is the white chocolate part, which constitute 85% of the product, and the other one is cookies, which constitute about 15%. So for the white chocolate part, it contains this ingredient: sugar, non-fat milk, cocoa butter, anhydrous milk fat, lactose emulsifier, which is in this case they use a natural emulsifier soya lecithin with the E code E322. Find out what's the meaning of E number here, and polyglycerol polyricinoloid E476. So these are the two emulsifiers used in combination in this product, and there's a reason why they use a blend of emulsifiers here: vanillin and preservative, which is tocopherol E306. And the cookies contain all these ingredients here. So for this one product here, there's a long list of ingredients and additives being used in this product. For those like public or layman, when they look at this ingredient, maybe it doesn't make much sense to them, because you know, probably they don't know what corn syrup, what is the difference between this and the other things, what is hydrogenated soybean, what is high fructose corn syrup, what is soya lecithin, and so on. But as a food technologist, now you should be able to explain each of these products. So it can be bewildering for non-food technologists because they don't understand. So these are the topics that we're going to cover. And because there are thousands of food ingredients that are available, so it's impossible for this course to cover each one of these. So what we can do here is we can group them or categorize them into a few groups having similar properties and serve specific functions. So as you can see here, each topic we will discuss about the classification of the ingredients, the properties of each of the ingredient in the specific group, their functions, and then the application. So when you study any ingredient, these are the things that you need to know. How do you classify, or and which category it belongs? What are the specific properties, the chemical properties, the physical properties, the functional properties, and how they can be applied in certain products? And then you can choose the right one for the right product to get the right functions. So the first one is the gums and stabilizers. This is also known as hydrocolloids. The main function, they have many functions, but one of the main functions is to prevent separation of food components during processing and storage. That's the reason why they are called stabilizers. But there are many, many more functions of this group of ingredients. They can be used as a gelling agent, as a stabilizing agent. They can be used, you know, to give viscosity, and so on. The second group is called emulsifiers. Emulsifiers can be used to prevent separation of immiscible phases, which, you know, basically when you have any food, or most food will contain fat or oil, and also aqueous phase. So we need to be able to mix them homogeneously so that they don't separate into two layers, because the tendency is for this immiscible phases to separate. So we want to form a stable emulsion. So emulsifiers are needed to form a stable emulsion. One of the common examples are mono and diglycerides in bakery products. The third category is flavorings or flavoring agents. Well, as the name implies, the function is to impart the characteristic flavor of the flavorings into the product. For example, the most common one is vanillin, to give the flavor of vanilla in ice cream. The fourth category, actually we can combine spices and seasonings under the flavorings category as well. And basically this is to give us the variety of spicy flavors to the food. Oops. And another group is called acidulants or acids. These are basically organic acids, not mineral acids. They are commonly used in food. They can serve as buffers or as acids to control the pH, or even as a alkalizing agent or neutralizing agent. For example, we use citric acid in jellies, or the phosphoric acid in carbonated beverages. Another group is sweeteners. to provide sweetness, to enhance and modify overall flavor. So these are the common sweeteners that we use, sugar like sucrose, glucose syrup, and aspartame, which is the artificial or non-calorific sweetener. The other group is protein ingredients. This will provide emulsification property, foaming property, water binding. The common one, whey and casein isolate, whey protein, caseinates, soy protein concentrate. The other one is salts. Well, salts can provide saltiness, can enhance the overall flavor. For example, the most common one, table salt or sodium chloride. Another category or group is called dough conditioners. We use this in bakery products, bakery goods, to improve the processing and product quality during bread making. This include enzyme, raising agents, for example, the ammonium carbonate and so on, and oxidizing agent. The other group is called colorings, to give, of course, the various colors that make the food more attractive to the consumers. For example, we have tartrazine, annatto, caramel. So we have a selection of synthetic as well as natural colors. Last but not least, we have also a so-called nutraceutical group. This is basically to provide a specific physiological benefit or protection against chronic disease. For example, nowadays we have more and more products added with antioxidants, isoflavone, and psyllium. And some other miscellaneous small group of products, for example, humectants and firming agent. So let's look at some of these groups in general. Of course, we are going to cover in more detail in each of these topics. The first one is actually gum and stabilizers. So you can see these are the example of product that where you can find the gum and stabilizers or hydrocolloids. The in product like ice cream here, the gum or the hydrocolloid play a certain function, for example, mainly as a stabilizer to stabilize the foam in the ice cream, and also to give a desirable, nice mouthfeel, to give that kind of a smooth mouthfeel when we eat the ice cream. So gum and stabilizers can be used to control the consistency of liquid and semi-liquid food and prevent separation of food components during processing and storage. And that's why it is called, they are called stabilizers, to stabilize the emulsion, to give the long-term stabilization to the emulsion and prevent the separation of the food component. And also to give a certain, a nice mouthfeel, smooth mouthfeel. But they also have other functional properties as a suspending agent to suspend the particulates in the suspension, to prevent setting, to as a gelling agent, and also to provide a so-called bulking properties. What does it mean by bulking properties? It actually to give certain kind of body to the product. If you think of a sugar solution, water and sugar, and you drink the solution, it doesn't have the body. But when you add, let's say, pectin or xanthan gum or any hydrocolloids, Arabic gum, into the sugar solution, you will get some viscosity, and that will give so-called the bulk, the bulking properties. So example of hydrocolloids or gum and stabilizers is sodium alginate. These are commonly used in as a stabilizer in ice cream. Carrageenan can be used as stabilizer in evaporated milk. Both sodium alginate and carrageenan can form a gel, but they form gel and under different conditions. For example, sodium alginate will require calcium to form a gel, but carrageenan can form gel in the presence of potassium, for example. Emulsifiers. So these are a common example of product where we will find or we need to use emulsifiers in the coffee whitener, for example. in the bread. So they are used to prevent separation of immiscible phases, where you have the fat or oil phase. Vinegar is an example of aqueous phase, which basically water-based, and to form the stable emulsion. Emulsifiers would facilitate the dispersion of fat in water-based system. And this is especially in the product like coffee whitener. If the fat is not dispersed nicely, then you will get a separation. So this is where the phenomenon, like in the coffee whitener, where, you know, when you add the coffee, when you add the coffee whitener into the product, into the, you know, sometimes you can get kind of the fat separation. This is sometimes called feathering, which is basically a separation of fat, because emulsifiers, we don't use the right emulsifiers, or we don't use emulsifiers at all. Emulsifiers can be also used as foaming agent to stabilize the dispersion of a gas in liquid media. So this is in the foam kind of product. For example, in ice cream. Ice cream is an example of solid foam, where you know a large percentage of in the ice cream is actually contain air. So we need to stabilize the air bubble or the foam. We can use emulsifiers for this purpose. It can actually give volume and texture to many big products like the bread in this picture. And then it can give a nice, texture for to the bread or to the cake. Common example of emulsifiers, there are many of them, but common one is actually mono and diglycerides in margarine, in bakery products. The other group is flavorings. We know that flavorings, of course, to impart characteristic flavor of the flavoring. The common one that I put here is vanillin, to give the flavor of vanilla to ice cream. A lot of people love the vanilla flavor, and the main actually flavoring compound is actually in the vanilla, and it's actually extracted from the vanilla bean. So the function of flavoring agent is to augment, to complement, or to modify flavor. For example, we can use vanillin in the chocolate based product to modify the flavor of chocolate or cocoa. So that will give us a kind of a different kind of products. Actually, we can be very creative in mixing the different flavor to get a different kind of flavor. The limit is, it's almost unlimited in what kind of flavor we can use if we know how to blend them or how to use them in different kind of products. And to mask the original flavor, we can also use flavor to mask or to kind of, to hide the undesirable original flavor. For example, we can use anise to cover the bitter medicinals in cough syrup and so on, so that the bitter taste not very significant. And there are various types of natural and synthetic flavor that you're going to learn in this topic. The next group is acidulants or acid. We are talking about organic acid here, which can be used as a buffer in the food product, as acids, alkalis, and also as neutralizing agent. It will modify the degree of acidity, and this is important in the processing and preparation of many food. For example, in the fruit jam making, we need to make sure the pH is within a narrow range of, around 2.5 to 3.8. So in order to get within that range, we have to use certain acid. And the pH of the food, which is controlled by the acidity or the type of acid present and the amount of acid present, are important because they can affect the color or the stability of the color, texture, and also the flavor. For example, the acids present in fruit juice that we can add also, apart from the natural acids, we can also add another acid in the jam making, which we can use. Usually we use citric acid, jellies, carbonated beverages, and canned food. And we have to use different kind of organic acid to get a different effect or different functions. The next group is colorings. Of course, there are sayings, we eat with our eyes rather, you know, because we always attracted to the vibrant color of the food, especially children. Before food is tasted, before a single bite is even taken, the quality of that food is judged by how it looks. So colorings are actually being used basically to make the food more attractive. It doesn't affect the texture, it doesn't affect the taste or the flavor of the food. It doesn't serve those function other than just giving or making the food more attractive. So usually the primary attribute consumers consider in making purchasing decision, you know, the vibrant, attractive color of the food usually also associated sometimes with the quality, although it's not the case. So synthetic and natural colors confer attractive colors to the food. These are some of the common examples that are permitted under the law, under our Food Act. Tartrazine, 0.04R, carotina, which is the natural color, annatto, also a natural color, and also caramel. A few miscellaneous foods ingredients that we use or additive that we can use to modify properties of protein and starch in cereal-based food. So this is under the category of dual conditioners. And this results in improved properties such as reduced mixing time and increased loaf volume. Can produce more uniform bakery products with good crumb structure. Examples are various phosphates, sulfates, and also enzyme. Anti-caking agent. This is an example of a small minor type of ingredients that serve also important function. For example, in the powdered products like salt, milk, powder, and so on, when we store them for a long time, they can actually form lumps or stick. The particle will stick to each other, and this phenomenon called caking, lumping, and agglomeration during storage, which make it hard to, you know, to use. So we can add, usually anti-caking agents are added to dry ingredients such as salt, powdered sugar, finely ground spice blends. Example of common anti-caking agents is calcium silicate that is used in salt mixtures. So basically, that's for this presentation. Just give you the learning outcome so that you are clear. Always come back and check the learning outcome to make sure that you have covered everything while you are doing the revision, for example. And also, I have explained to you and give you the topics that we are going to cover in the whole course IMK 221 food ingredients.